peace to the family. So it's jacuzzi time, folks. Yeah, it's jacuzzi time. Just getting a little something in. Having a good time, some me time. Got a relaxed body. Just doing somewhere to work out. So you know how that get. Once you start working the body out, you want to loosen up the muscles just a little bit. Because the homie's a little tense. But I just want to talk to you right now. Let's find a little free time to talk to you about economic sovereignty. Economic sovereignty, very important. And in our culture, as far as New Covenant is concerned, we like to call it Kuina Agunu. What is Kuina Agunu? Kuina Agunu is what we define as spiritual freedom. It is the epitome of what the theme of this evening is called economic sovereignty. You cannot have economic sovereignty unless you have Kuina Agunu, which is spiritual freedom. You can't have spiritual freedom unless there's economic sovereignty. And by economic sovereignty, we just mean autonomy over the manner in which you choose to generate revenue in retrospect to the way you intend to live. So earlier on, I spoke to y'all about owning the property and calling it a home versus your office. And before you have a home, you must have an office. And they've created this scenario amongst us where we would like to consider our home a house, or our house a home, when in fact we're living paycheck to paycheck, or bill to bill, or we just have a few funds in excess after we handle our most immediate needs. And if that's the case, then what we need to do is say to ourselves, you know what, this home has to be turned into the office. Where you live has to be turned into the abode where we make money. It's so weird, because it's not actually weird. The psychology is, home is not where you're supposed to make money. You have to leave home to make money. And that's what takes you out to your entrepreneurial state of mind in the first place. Home base should be where you generate your revenue, especially if you're thinking as an entrepreneur. That's where the inventions should be made. That's where the creativity should take place. As opposed to saying, well, I'm leaving this place to go somewhere to start making money. Then in between, there's no creativity, because now you're just using your house to sleep in. And again, remember that I told you that you want to use your trust and put your home as a corporate dwelling so you can write off your bills and your taxes, so you can make your mortgage cheaper, your rent cheaper, in addition to your light bill, your gas, and other utilities. Thanks a lot, Robert McLean. I'm always doing my best to spit that fire, kick that truth. So, you know, there's many different things that you can do with real estate, like amelioration and restitution of property, which is more in depth in terms of just saying rehabbing property. Like I was saying before in a previous stream, I don't like saying the word flip when we talking about real estate, because the houses aren't exactly doing somersaults, and even though it's a term that many of us like to use colloquially, it's out of context. And it's not specific to the cause, because there's any of a number of different things that you can do to generate revenue from properties or real estate, and we need to specify that so we can demonstrate properly in our communication. In our deliberations, we want to make sure that people understand what we're talking about. When my mentees come to me and say, for life, I want to flip some properties, I'm like, what do you mean by that? Then they go blank. And I'm like, so that's why we don't want to use that terminology no more. I want you to say exactly what you got in mind. Okay? And so, again, if you're interested in the mentorship program or the consultations, which are $200 an hour, $300 an hour in person, and the mentorship obviously costs more, but it pays, and that's when I coach you for about 2 months on it or more, then you make sure you hit me at brother, PoliGht45@gmail.com. You know, when I squeeze some free time in to show some love, I'm always going to do these streams. I know it's kind of late, but this was the opportunity that I got today to be able to share some information, so I'm just going for it. Just going for it. Okay? Peace to the family. Thanks a lot, Betty. I'm going to constantly bring that information to the best of my ability. One thing that you could do to generate money, when people say OPM or other people's property, one thing that you can do, still gonna cost money nonetheless, but it won't cost you as much money as the conventional approach to flipping houses or selling houses. Here's one thing that you can do. One thing that you could do is you can actually have an agreement to sell properties on assignment. And when you sell properties on assignment, this means that you can solicit properties that you have not purchased for yourself and sell it back. In other words, you could go around and ask some people if they're interested in selling their property, right? Or what's the dollar amount that they're interested in selling the property for? And if they tell you a dollar amount that's becoming, as far as you saying, you know what, this person only wants $40,000 to sell this property, and you talk to them, you say, well, anything that I can do over that market, would you mind if I could still get the sale so long as I get the dollar amount you're interested in? They say yes. So now you have that property on assignment. And now you could go around to several parties and see if they wouldn't mind you soliciting their real estate on their behalf, provided you can make your monies, but your monies won't compromise the integrity of whatever profit they're looking to make. And this is called selling real estate on assignment. And therefore, it costs you no money. Now, what you would want to do, you want to get a real estate attorney so someone could be held accountable for a binding agreement. So you get a real estate attorney to generate an instrument that stipulates that you'll be having these properties sold on assignment. And it can cost you anywhere between $300 to $600 for the most part. And, you know, we're dealing with something that's not too technical, and it's just, it's kind of minuscule as far as what you're doing. You're just looking to see if you can sell a property that somebody's looking to get off their hands. And the dollar amount isn't that huge. You get a real estate attorney, and they probably won't charge you more than $300 to $600 to put together a nice contract or agreement, in which case you have the right to sell properties or solicit property on behalf of the seller, right? And in this, you don't need no credentials to do any of this. And this is you making money without having to spend money necessarily. Sure, you may have to pay a real estate attorney to cover yourself. So we could say, you know what, you get one that's corresponding to that jurisdiction to generate an instrument that stipulates your relationship with the seller in retrospect to their ownership of the property, which and them giving you the right to solicit that property to an interested buyer for a profit. And if you want to take it to the next level, you get an EMD, which is called an earnest money deposit. I know it's pretty late for this information, but it is what it is. And with an earnest money deposit, that's when you tell the potential buyer, you create a purchase agreement and you let them know why you want a purchase agreement. You tell them you're setting up a purchase agreement because you want to just give them the right, exclusive right, to be able to have you not sell this property to no one else inside of 30 to 45 business days or something like that. 30 business days, 45 business days. You say, you know what, we're gonna hold ourselves to the notion that you're gonna buy this property, but what we can do in your favor is guarantee you we will not offer this property to no one else inside of, let's say, 45 business days. What we need from you in order for us to do that is for you to put down an EMD, which is an earnest money deposit. Now, why do you want an earnest money deposit? You want an earnest money deposit because with this, they know that they may have to put up 10% of the dollar amount or what have you of the property, right? Or 20% of the dollar amount, or, you know, 25% of the dollar amount. So let's say it's a $40,000 property. You say, you know what, I want 20% down earnest money deposit. So they put their $8,000 down. And the thing is, they understand with an earnest money deposit, you cannot get this $8,000 back. This $8,000 is now making me more forthcoming to say, well, you know what, I'm not going to bargain or solicit this property to no other person, no matter who's interested in it, no matter what they say they're willing to pay, even if it's more than you. Because now that you've put down an earnest money deposit, saying that you're willing to lose this money if you don't come with the rest of the money, I'm willing to also say that I will not sell this property to anyone inside of this span of time via the purchase agreement. So now you got a purchase agreement, you got your real estate attorney, you got your earnest money deposit, you're selling this property on assignment, and you have the buyer and the seller corresponding. and this costs you probably $300-$600 total by the time you're done. And you can still make yourself a nice profit depending on your markup. And of course, what you're gonna do, you're gonna study the comps or the comparable properties. Comps are the properties. We gotta get some more bubbly up in here. We gotta get the bubbly up in here. You kidding me? Sorry about that. We gotta get that bubbly up in there. Gotta get that bubbly up in there. Good. Can't play around with that. Can't play around. We need that bubbly, people. Without the bubbly, there can be no funny. We need the bubbly. Okay, where was we at in conversation? Where was we at? Okay, so we had the earnest money deposit. We have the purchase agreement. Peace, Deborah. How you doing? Earnest money deposit, purchase agreement, real estate attorney, selling on assignment, and of course, just giving you the exact words and terms that correspond with the specific genre of real estate. That's right, EMDs. Just call it EMD. I don't make up these terms. And so I give you this nomenclature, that's what we call it, and the nomenclature is a specific set of words. Nomenclature is a specific set of words that are corresponding to a genre in particular. It's vocabulary that caters specifically to that genre. So even if the words are normally used differently in a context outside of that forum, you won't be lost when it comes into a context corresponding with this new genre, because now you're saying, okay, I understand. Quantitatively speaking, that these words are going to take on a different complexion. These words are going to take on a different meaning. And it suffices to say that it's important to learn these words, to get the right vocabulary right. So you don't get lost in the sauce when they get used. You don't want to get lost in interpretation, none of that. So, very important. The email is brotherpolight45@gmail.com. brotherpolight45@gmail.com. Word. Hold on, y'all. Whoa. Whoa. Oh, man. You know, I travel, man. Constantly traveling, man. But I gotta make sure I get my health in, get it in where I can fit it in, and also build with the family. Always leave your full name and your email. Someone said, why is it so hard for black people to get over the hurdle? What I mean is financially, economically. Because black people have a tendency to keep it real. And by keeping it real, they don't connect with people that they need to, because the people they need to connect with aren't so-called real. You know, you want to hang out with the people. Like, if it's a conscious community thing, you normally want to hang out with the teacher that curses up a storm and speaks aggressively about oppression and the things that we should do and the things that they will do and the type of person they are and the type of people you need to be. And those people will keep you broke most times because they have nothing to offer you fiscally or financially. They can't empower you. But what they can do is invigorate you for a few moments and give you some ideas about being angry, about things you probably should be angry about. And in that zealousness, you get lost in the mire of those convictions and therefore find that you can't pull nothing off. Right? And so, That's the issue. So when the brother asks, who asked that question? Why is it so hard for black people to get over the hurdle? What I mean is financially, economically. Hold on real quick. Yes, family, peace. Sorry for the pause. Okay, so remember, you always could contact me, brother, PLIJHT45@gmail.com. If you're interested in getting a consultation, or ready, I should say, if you're ready to get a consultation, $200 an hour, $300 in person, you can always contact me at brother, PLIJHT45@gmail.com. Always leave your full name and your phone number. Always leave your phone number, people. Always leave your phone number. Other than that, there's the mentorship program, which is more elaborate in detail, which is where you grow your abundance. And, you know, oftentimes, you know, people play double dutch when it comes to growing wealth, and I get it. But that's part of the reason. Per the brother's question, how come it's so hard for black people to get over the hurdle? Because no amount of truth can you disseminate to black people will many of them take heed, because then they have the other black people in their corner. Yeah, I don't know about that. Or you do it because, you know, my man did something like that before and it didn't work out. And, you know, we got a lot of that going on in the community. So therefore, you're always hesitant, you're always skeptical, and you always procrastinate when it's your time to come up. And that's why we fail so often. So when the brother asks, how come? I'm just giving you a plethora of answers. But really, it's just the people you surround yourself by. I love what LeBron has done with the school. That's just amazing. So it's all about who you surround yourself with. You know, you put yourself in the right company, the right company is gonna help you erect the right business. Hence the term company, pun intended. Wealth does begin at 150K. 250K is a different standard per the S&Ps. 150K is still a standard. If you want to talk about hyperinflation and projections, we could work our way over there, but still 150 is the standard. 150 is the standard. Now, if you're talking about the median income per certain cities, then we can get into the technicality, but we're talking about the median rate or the average for the nation. The average for the nation is going to be 150. Per certain counties, the number will definitely change. That's a fact. For any means, Rick, that asks me, why do I say 150 instead of 250K? Jeremy Love, no doubt, man. I'm glad that you learned about making money off those game tickets from myself. Glad you listened. That means I'm not speaking in vain, and I don't mind continuing to speak so long as I know you're using the information. I ain't go to no economic school. The school of thought I went to was called poverty, and I was just tired of it. And school of thought also called black women looking in your face, waiting for you to make something happen. And you got children. That was enough to get me to focus in the right direction, and then I started surrounding myself by the right people. And yes, I surrounded myself by a lot of pro-black, pan-African, black conscious brothers and sisters, and it served its purpose, and it's still very valuable, still very important to do. But when you see that people are lacking in certain information, you gotta go out and get it, no matter who has it, no matter what race, no matter what environment, no matter what community, you gotta go and get it, because at the end of the day, we are obligated to our family. We are obligated to ourselves. If I'm no good to myself, I'm no good to my family. If I'm no good to my family, I'm no good to the community. So we have to put these things in proper perspective. We have to empower ourselves so we can empower others. I have to learn how to help me so I can help you. Help yourself. That's how that's going to work. Word. I don't know why it's necessary to ask me if I still believe in aliens. What is that all about? I believe there's life outside of planet Earth. I just don't spend too much time speculating upon it. I think it's pretty practical to believe in a vast universe such as this one, that there's life on planet Earth. I just don't want to make up stories about them. If that helps you out, Tommy Isaiah Guns, who said you still believe in aliens, there's nothing to believe in. is just common sense at this particular point. There's no way that we could be the only existence here in boundless space. But the real question this time is, why are you deviating from the economic information? Which goes back to the other brother's question, how come it's so hard for black people to get over the hurdle? One of the answers is our attention span. And once we start talking about things that's not conventionally spoken about, we normally have a short attention span when it counts the most for us to pay attention. And that's because we've been groomed to watch Love and Hip Hop, nothing wrong with it per se, but we put too much of this information in our mind in disproportionate ratio. Shout out to Senate President, man. I'm glad you watch it. We put too much. I hope you replay it if you just came in, my brother. Yeah. People share weird videos to the group, all of that, but it is what it is. It happens. We gotta appreciate that for what it is. Oh, the water's dope. You know, I like what's going on these days, because now when I get into pools, I get into jacuzzis, it be salt water instead of chlorine. So I like the salt water fix. It's real dope. Forex stocks is pretty cool. I'm not a huge fan of it, but it's pretty cool. I'm with it. Yeah, Kane, it's talking that talk, so I definitely want you to catch up with it. Jew for president. Mentorship program, it varies depending on which income stream program you're buying into. That's why you should send your email and your phone number, and then we'll gather what it is that you need to get done. Or if it's just simply a consultation you may need, which is 200 hours, 300 in person. Of course, I will always suggest the mentorship program is more elaborate and detailed, and I only can take X amount of people at a time when I deal with it. Why? Because I'm the one coaching people directly. So because I'm coaching people directly, yeah, gotta wipe it. Sometimes Facebook elects to put a thumbnail up there, and I have all this water on my face, and it'll look like bumps. Herbert Williams, you're welcome, man. To spend a day with me is still $1,500. It depends on what we're going to count as an actual day. But, you know, you book 6 hours time, we work something out. Use the insurance to pay off the house by having an equitable trust and assigning a trust to the insurance policy. You know, ask the best questions you can ask so it can save you some time and energy from the consultations. I take the time out. I actually be answering questions when they get asked. I may not catch them all, but I do make the best effort. How do I feel about that brother? You want to hear my personal opinions? I don't want to give my personal opinions about a brother who's doing some work in the community. I'd rather him just do what he got to do. I don't want to talk about that brother or no other person. So Tommy Isaiah, I don't know if you're really looking to provoke energies or you just sincerely asking things that can cause us to provoke energies. Oh, I'm keeping an eye on you, Tommy Isaiah. I don't know if you're really interested in this. One minute you asked me about aliens, now you want to ask me how I feel about another brother that's teaching in the community. I don't like the questions you're asking me, brother. I don't want to give you my opinion about another man. It's not that kind of stream for me to give you my opinion about another man. That is just, we was talking economics, and there's no reason to deviate and talk about that. How did you learn this much about economics? From any means, Rick. From being forced to have to get out of poverty and just sticking with it until something finally worked. I don't actually charge $1,500 to spend a day with me. I actually charge more. But Arkell Bailey says, you charge $1,500 just to spend a day with you. Your boy is from Brooklyn. You're supposed to give that wisdom up. I don't know where you're getting this wacky information from. If I take a day out of... Do you know what I did today? If, let's say someone wanted to pay me to spend a a day with me. Whatever a day equals to them, because I'm sure it's not 24 hours. That's going to be ridiculous. Yeah, I really have to tax you. You know, I would have to, like today, if I had to charge you to spend a day with me, that would be a day of me not doing what I do during the day. Now, who did I meet up with today? Today, I met up with who? Nana Kwame, right? And who's this Nana Kwame? This is only a guy, near billionaire, has hundreds of millions of dollars, who's building a whole city in Ghana, and damn near any huge sky rise, tall building, skyscraper, upscale community in Ghana, he owns it, or he's built it, I should say. Okay, this man is building a city. And this is an African brother. You could go on my Instagram or you could look on the Facebook. And I got to sit down and build with this brother. This brother is fond of my speaking and even offered to hire me. And in a certain capacity. I'm not going to speak on it. But it's an honor that the brother appreciates what I bring to the table, right? And it's an honor that the brother suggested to hire me for a service that I can render per my own company, my own business. And to be able to speak with this brother, you can look him up, but you can check it out on my Instagram, you can check it out on my Facebook. Now, if you were to hire me to speak to you today, I would not be in that conversation with him today because I'd be attending to you. Speak with a billionaire who wants to hire me for services that I can render per a company that I created, or make sure I hook up my man who's also from Brooklyn to spend the whole day with me that I don't know from nowhere, but he's from Brooklyn, I'm from Brooklyn, so whatever. See how that worked? It don't work like that. I'm not going to be successful if I keep thinking like that, you know, because the amount of people that I could just spend the day with and build with, I'd be Xing me out of the opportunity to create opportunity for people as I'm in a position to also empower other people. Alright, because when I come up, y'all come up. That's just how the mentality is supposed to be. You should want to come up so you can help other people, right? But at the same rate, help people in what capacity? When I'm doing these streams, this is me spending some time with you. And you got thousands of hours of me doing these free streams that I add up to days and days and days and months. Maybe even years, as much as hours as I put up for free online. So that's the way we got to approach it. But I could be honestly missing opportunities during my day per the network that I'm dealing with to just do a solid for several people every single day, and it would accumulate to the point where I would give away so much time and energy for people that I want to be mad at, because I'll start feeling undercompensated by no fault of your own, because you're just an honest brother who just says, yo, I need the love. We're from the same community, from the same neighborhood, same state. Yo, show me the love. I totally understand that. And when the time suffices, you get that. Like when I come out to Brooklyn in September, as we organizing the gang members and having a cookout, that's the best time. I'm coming out there, I'm using my own monies, flying out there and doing the organizing. If you're not scared of a few gang members, well, a lot of gang members, but they on the positive vibe. They ask me to host the event. If you're okay with that, you come out, that's the day to get your free info. I won't be able to speak to you exclusively for the whole day, but that's the day to connect with the brother and say, let's build. You know, I'm going to be giving away some free alkaline food. We're going to be cooking it. And that's it. Then my homies and them still going to have some of that that poison they're cooking. And it's all right. It's all right. It's a growth process. But I'm definitely going to make sure I'm giving some free vegan food away to them to give them an alternative means. And once they taste it and they realize what's going on, they'll be ashamed of themselves. But right now, I'm not going to tell them, don't cook that other food, because they got to be part of the event as well. This is what they are. I'm just going to bring a healthy alternative and warm people up to the idea. But anyway, that's another thing. I don't want to digress. But the point of the matter is, my brother, with no offense intended, and I mean no disrespect whatsoever, I want to let you know that the things that I do during my day is as valuable as the time that I may charge for when I'm working with another brother or sister in the community. Because to charge for the amount of time I'm giving information is to also say, this is what my time is worth when I'm not doing the things that I do traditionally outside of this. And there is no healthy dollar amount because I feel I'm worth more than the amount that I have to charge when people want to spend the day and bill. And I normally qualify a day as 6 hours, 8 hours max. I call that the day, you know, because there's going to be a break time that we don't count. So we looking at damn near 10 hours, you know, because it's going to be 2 hours worth of break, whether we do 2 hours in a row or vice versa. You know, when I have people spend the day with me, I normally let them roll with me. They come to certain meetings that I be having. People that tell you, I be having meetings with celebrities. If they book me on the day I have the meetings and they want to roll with me for the day, you going to follow me to the meeting. I just ask that you be humble and don't infuse yourself in the conversation if it's not warranted or if I don't give you the green light. I just want you to see how I get down, how I do my business, and the respect that I get from people that have a huge fan base. And that's worth a lot of bread, too. No doubt, Jube. I hope you definitely there. You know, we in there. I'm going to send you the flyer. But I'm out there. I hope y'all come from out of town and do what you got to do. It's a community event. You know, we want to stop the violence, but we don't just want to talk about stopping the violence. I'm opening up a bookstore in my community as well. So we talk about all of that stuff. Well, the community I came from. So we talk about all of that, and it's creating a flagship, hopefully, that other communities can follow after we put in the work that we're going to put in. Yeah, that's what it is, man. I'm just building with you. Remember, you go to Brother PLIGHT 45 at gmail.com if you're interested in the mentorship program and or consulting. Consulting costs $200 an hour. No need to call me and ask me how does it work. I gotta tell you now how it works. You'll pay. We'll confirm the date and the time. I'll send you some questions for you to answer. The reason why I send you questions for you to answer and for you to send me some questions is so that way we got a general concept of what you need done so we don't have to burn into the time for the actual consultation. That's just being honest. I don't want to ask you orientation type questions. I want to get that on paper, make my assessment so I could bring something to the table to you when it's time to communicate with you certain ideas. All right, so that's how you get the most for your money and how you create a better opportunity for me to deliver a powerful service towards you. So you make the payment. That way that solidifies the date and the time. You don't make the payment, I'm not taking the date and the time serious. I would like to talk to you in the month of October, then don't hit me up yet. Especially unless you want to pay to lock down that specific date, then you can hit me up. But for consultations, this is all you got to know. You have to pay for it. That'll confirm the date and the time. I'll forward you some questions. We'll interact like that. And hopefully we do it the same day within 48 hours. But if you want to push it past that time, it's all good. But confirming the date is important. That's important. And the date doesn't get confirmed unless there's a payment. So that way I'm not making time out. And then you decide, I'm not going to pick up the phone because I'm embarrassed and I'm not buying. Believe it or not, people did this so many times that I had to say I have to get paid first. Because people will say they want to do something and then they'll be embarrassed and they will never pick up their phone again. Even though they'll tell you, call me at this time, I'm ready. And then they don't pick up. Or people say, yo, okay, I'm about to make the payment right now. And so we locked in for this time. I'm like, okay, we locked in this time. You about to do it now? I'm about to do it now. And they'll never call you back. Until 2-3 months later, they watch something on YouTube or Facebook. And then they back doing the same thing again when they call you. Yo, I'm just calling you to let you know I'm about to be on. Just give me 3 more months. You don't got to do that. It's all right. You know what I'm saying? When you're ready, you're ready. You ain't got to do that. So this is what I mean why I be having the charge, because stuff like that is time consuming. And it's debilitating and it's draining because it's like, man, we wasting time. You took away from someone I could have called. Now I ain't talking to nobody for the rest of the day because I didn't talk to as much people I could talk to for the day. I'm done. So that's how that works. But yeah, like I said, today was a powerful day. Speaking to my African brother, damn near billionaire. You know, it ain't too many days you can sit down and your conversation be entertained by a black man in the billionaire range who's creating a city literally being built as we speak in Africa, in Ghana. That doesn't happen every day. So when someone says, yo, you charging $1,500 for someone to speak to you for the day, and I say, correction, I charge more than $1,500 for someone to hang out with me for the day, first of all. and for me to teach correction. You know, I mean nothing condescending by it. And I'm not even mad at the brother that asked about it. Am I still affiliated with New Covenant? Come on, bro. What's up with you? I created New Covenant. What are you talking about? Am I still affiliated with it? Ain't nobody took it and ran from it. New Covenant is all the way up. Brad, Ona, Carter, it's all good, man. It's all love, man. I don't take no offense to anybody who's not purposely looking to waste time. After a while, you be purposely wasting time. I'd be like, man, that's wild, bro. Like, you could just left me alone. Because so many people sending emails and texts, I can't catch them all. So I always hope that whoever's calling is calling, coming correct and sincere, because I can't get to everybody in one shot. The only people I can obligate myself to is people once they pay for something. I gotta obligate myself to them. After that, I can't obligate myself to just random people. So when I speak with them, I hope it's sincere and it's quality. Brother, I ain't feel no disrespect, Arkell Bailey. I don't want you to feel like I thought you was being disrespectful. I'm actually speaking about other people's sentiments. Yours is very peaceful and positive, you know, so I don't want you to think I feel any way about you, my brother, Arkell Bailey. You brought up something that was good conversation, and I wanted to explain to people why I may charge X amount of money for someone to spend time with me during the day and for me to build. And like I said, people will spend time with me during the day and I get the build on. That's a whole different situation, because whatever I got going on, while I'm in the Rolls Royce, you up in the Rolls Royce. You may think that means nothing to nobody, but it's all about energy. If you get to experience somebody rolling around in a $400,000, $300,000 car, or jump out of the $300,000 car and say, hey, yo, let me lighten up. Let me get into something light and get into the 150K i8. You know, this $400,000 car, the situation don't really call for it. You know, and you know, people tell you stuff like, oh man, you bought the car, though, it depreciates the second you get off the lot. You know, save that crap for non-educated people. You know, people not in the same tax bracket tend to think they understand everything going on with people that's in a larger or greater tax bracket. Let me explain something to you. My ghost appraises for 650K upward. Okay? Because it's 1 in 10. I bought it the way it was for a reason. And so the value in which I bought it for more than doubled because I paid for it up front. Okay, that's when you really win, when you pay for the car up front. Now, I wouldn't suggest you pay for a car up front that would depreciate immediately for the time you get off the lot. I would say, man, just lease the car. If that be the case, at least you can upgrade and change. And as long as you conform to the miles per hour rules and all that other stuff they want, you good. But in the other instances where the car will appraise for more money than what it was worth when you first bought it, then it stands to reason for me to purchase it cash out, you know, straight through. Because one, it'll be cheaper that way. That's one. And I can alleviate a lot of taxes. Two, speaking of taxes, I can cash this car out for over 600K anytime I'm ready. So guess what happens with that? Certified. Guess what happens with that? If I had over $650,000 in the bank, I would have to pay taxes on it in five figures. Okay? I would have 60 grand or more I would have to pay in taxes for just having 650K idly sitting in the bank, unless I got a nice tax shelter or investment vehicle that stipulates otherwise. But in a general sense, just me keeping 650K upward in the bank, I'm going to have to pay some tens of thousands of dollars in taxes. But if I have 650 grand in the form of a car that I can cash out at any time, but I keep that money in the form of the car, then guess what? My taxes on the Ghost is only $1,800. Okay? My taxes on the Ghost is only $1,800. You may say $1,800 for a car? Taxes on a car? You gotta pay $1,800? Yeah, but imagine taxes on $650,000. So by me keeping the money in the form of a car, I'm saving money on taxes. I can pay for this thing 10 years out and I wouldn't pay as much as taxes after paying 1 year for my 650K. So I know what I'm doing here. So miss me with the whole, oh man, you know, the second you buy that car, it depreciates. You know what you could have did with that money? It is money in the form of a car. When I'm ready to cash it out, there we go. I've avoided the tax man legally. See? Legally. Come on, man. I'm telling you. And this is different talk. Because owning a Rolls Royce is like owning a house plus another situation. Because you're not dealing with regular car bills at that particular point. Because first of all, if you'd even be able to get one, it's a whole nother conversation. Because they really, it's a status car. So they really don't want outrage particularly having the car. I'm going to tell you that right now. The forces that be, they've created certain vehicles that have a certain criteria for you to be, even be able to embark upon the acquisition of it. It's a fact. And anyone that has a Ghost and went about purchasing it legitimately without the homeboy hookup, they know it comes with all sorts of strings attached. I could do a video on that alone. The type of paperwork, the type of taxes and all. And you don't go through that for even a Lamborghini. You go through that for a Ghost because there's a whole history behind who they wanted to drive it, who they wanted to drive that vehicle, and the demographic to represent status. And therefore, when you have it, you create a conversation in itself. Having it. And that's what a lot of my brothers and sisters do not understand. I purchase conversational pieces in the form of clothes, in the form of vehicles, and I make sure I have the eye for conversational pieces. So when I'm in an environment, I'm able to say, just like when I'm speaking to the homie today, you know, my billionaire brother, brother Nana, when I'm building with him today, I'm like, yo. And the person I was consulting, because I was hired to do an in-person consultation, actually. You know, I was building with him, and I was like, yo, bro, first time we connected, I was breaking down. Yo, I noticed the bag you had, this, that, and the third. I noticed this, and those shoes, and those, this, that, and the third. Even in the middle of me conversing with people, this was something that I picked up. And long story short, a lot of times I sit there, and I'd be able to say, man, that watch costs, that timepiece is bread. Or this. And it gives me a sense of what kind of culture, what type of culture a person's coming from. Not culture, like African culture. We talking financial culture. You know, a person's style or degree of, a person's degree of style or criteria and what they're able to demonstrate in the moment would suggest to us a certain profile of living, especially when you couple it with the environment that you're in. So in other environments, people doing their best to stunt, as we say. And then there's some things you just can't stunt. You can stunt with a piece of something, but when you got a collection of things working out, chances are it is what it is. Even though you can still be fooled, chances are it is what it is. And so understanding the culture of a person and understand the environment that you're in and the probability that these people are the real deal, your conversation changes. The way you approach them, the way they approach you. Because they're there occupying the same space as you. So what are you doing there? You know? And then now there's a certain, well, we meet each other at eye level because, hey, we're both here. And this is a red carpet event. Or we're both here and these seats cost $10,000. But on top of these $10,000, you know, there's no branding there. There's no names there. But sometimes you're able to pick up with the naked eye if you're really seasoned. Yo, even though there's no name glazed over those shoes or over that bag is over 12 grand. One time I'm around Mayweather and I know his jacket was over 40,000. I know that because I'm in the culture of it. I live a few blocks away from Rodeo in Beverly Hills. You feel what I'm saying? So I've seen that jacket. I actually know that costs 40 bands. So when I see it, I'm like, yo, dude got the $40,000 jacket. Of course, I already know Mayweather. But if I didn't, I'd have been like, yo, son is wearing a $40,000 jacket. I have an idea of how to approach this person's conversation. Like, I build with y'all about finance and economics, right? But when I'm around billionaires, it's not really to preference the conversation. They generally want to talk about metaphysics and crystals and all this stuff, especially white billionaires. finance is like, talking to a billionaire about finance may not be the most stimulating thing. A lot of them are tired of money in certain senses, tired of it in a certain sense. You know, it's not a conversation they're really driven to, depending on who they're communicating with, unless you bring something real powerful to the table. You know, but me sitting with a billionaire and telling them, I got an idea I want you to invest in, and it costs $20,000, it's almost laughable. It's just not the type of conversation to really have with somebody who's a billionaire. You got to be in experience to realize, damn, did I hit or miss? I missed. You got to be in experience to really understand that. Okay? You got to be in experience. So you got to know when one conversation is great in one setting, and in another setting it's met its maturation date. Some conversations just not gonna fly with certain people. Not that you can't offer anything of value, it's just not as enticing depending on where that person is. Now, spontaneously and naturally, should it come up, shine. But if it's like, you know what, I'm here working and I want to pique people's interest, I know better to really have that conversation. Chances are this conversation is better. That's how that works. So, you know, when you're building with people, like I said, that got over $100 million, $600 million, $1 billion, that's a different, you learn how to converse on a whole nother level. And then you take that conversation, you wind up, when you build with your people who are not in that tax bracket, you tend to be able to bring, add more value to conversation too with them, because now you become more refined in your communication, more specific and more exact about, or more tactical about your approach towards execution to become successful. And your perspective of success becomes different. And you realize the more wealthy people become, the more into holistic health they get into, to the next level, the technology and the food, you know, and metaphysics, the esoteric. You realize people get so wealthy that they want immediate access to the real things in life that we already know is very valuable, but we just don't have the access to it because we don't have the resources. You know, you look at someone like Mayweather, and you can say what you want to say about him. He's a very brilliant brother, and guess what? Out of all the rich black people you be seeing, I'll tell you this. To me, I believe he travels more than the most. That's what I know. I know for a fact he travels more than the most, and he touches every corner of planet Earth. He'll walk amongst the people, four corners of the planet Earth. He's gonna go to Egypt, he's gonna ride the camels, he's gonna go into the pyramids, he's gonna go to Greece, he's gonna go to Rome, he's gonna go to Thailand. He goes everywhere. He got that private jet. All these other brothers, they rent out the private jet and they barely go anywhere. This man got his own jet, not one but two. And he makes sure he travels the world to get the first-hand account, first-hand experience. Eat different types of foods, subject himself to different types of herbs, learn about different types of technology, and create different types of businesses. And in that, he learns how to communicate with different races. He learns about their cultures. He learns about the things that's coming off offensive and the things that's coming off respectful. Yo, he's very brilliant. And you can't take that away from anyone that can have access to the world like that. You can't think he's an idiot with as much as he travels. People got to really come out of their ego and realize there's a lot to be learned from that brother. So anytime I get a chance to sit down and build with that brother, it's always a blessing. Be it 5 minutes, be it for an hour. And he say, yo, come through, hang out with me for tonight. Oh, yo, I'm over here. Come through, bring your wife. Anytime I'm around me, it's a blessing. Because just being in the presence of somebody that's successful, in that culmination of energy that he's just harnessing from traveling everywhere, it's just worth it. You know, and especially being of the same race, that means a lot to me. That's why with Nana today, I'm like, yo, that means a lot to me to sit there and build with a brother that has so much. And we are damn near the same age. And this man has hundreds of millions of dollars and is a prince, an African prince. We watch this and coming to America and we watch TV. And, you know, they normally try to play it's like if somebody's a prince of Africa or a king. They're a king, but they ain't got no bread. Now, this brother's a bona fide prince, you know, on the verge of being a billionaire. Probably is, technically, if we count his assets and we went and played the net worth game. But anyway, as reported, he has hundreds of millions and building a city in Ghana. And, I mean, he's boss, man. His company is crazy with it. And it is a blessing to be able to just say in this lifetime, I got to sit down and speak with black people during an era where we get oppressed so much, during an era where many of us think we cannot make it, to say, yo, I've sat down, not just with some of the wealthiest white people in America, like James Zukin from Houlihan Lokey. You know, he owns the second biggest private investment bank in the world. It's all for me to come to his island where he is a neighbor of Bill Gates. I've been to people's islands, billionaires' islands. White people, old white Jews, whatever, fine. But you know what's also dope? I can say I've got the best of both worlds. Conversation from people to really put into context what success is in my evaluation. I can say, yo, I've been around the successful, wealthy white man at the level that you consider wealth to be wealth. And I can say I've been around the successful, wealthy black men, plural, who are on the verge of $1 billion or have $1 billion, and able to connect with them, and guess what? They still the homie, still brothers, but their conversation is so different when you really start building. And it's a conversation you will never catch on TV because they're marketing themselves. And that's the difference between the black billionaire and the white billionaire, because the white billionaire didn't really do it through sports, music, and entertainment. Nor is it as much of a spectacle as it is when a black person is very wealthy. When, you know, when we're extremely wealthy, it's like, damn, y'all guys overcame the odds. When white people are extremely wealthy, we're like, you should be wealthy, motherfucker. Your ancestors stole everything. You know what I'm saying? So, and that's why I've learned that a lot of wealthy white people tend to be so interested in wealthy black people, because the question is kind of like, how the heck did you still persevere? This is why Warren Buffett has that affinity to people like Mayweather and Jay-Z, where he's like, yo, he has all this money, he has all this knowledge, he has all the success, so why you want to be around black people who come out of poverty who made money? Because we're a phenomenon. It's like, how the heck did y'all wind up making it with all the 50 cent sodas killing your sperm count, the murder rate going on in the community, the fratricide, the genocide, all that, police brutality, poor education, lack of resources, broken family households, and you guys are still making hundreds of millions of dollars. Are you kidding me? And you managing to sustain it? Back in the days, we knew all black people gonna lose their money. We lasting a whole lot longer when we make money today. There's black people praying on people's minds, hoping that their own people go broke. But hey, we're managing to keep the money a whole lot more than we used to now. It's a fact. Whole lot longer. We're not seeing our great celebrities or our great stars turn around and suddenly they don't have no money no more and they go broke. We're not really seeing too much of that at the same rate we used to see it. We're getting paid more than we ever have before, and we're actually keeping the money now. I know we pray and hope that Mayweather goes broke. I know you pray and hope LeBron James goes broke, or pray and hope that Jay-Z go broke. Every day I pray and hope that they keep that money and make more. I don't care what they choose to do with it. Well, I do care. I'm not going to say that. But what they don't do with it is not my responsibility. That's their responsibility to decide how they ration out their money. All I tell myself is, if I'm so concerned about what they should do with the right type of money, I need to learn how to make the right type of money myself. Because I'm a man. I'm not going to count another man's pockets. But I'm going to use them for the greatest resource I can get out of them, which is the knowledge. Which is to hear an account of a person who was in the route that I am presently pursuing or ensuing. I told you I'm going to be the first conscious black billionaire. And when I say first conscious, I'm talking the way that I bring that heat with the debates and all that. Yo, all of that is coming back out. I'm just going to make this billion real quick. Y'all going to see something y'all never saw before. So when I'm over here sitting down having real estate meetings and sessions with billionaires, I don't take none of that for granted. It don't even be that hard for me to find those situations. I'm magnetized to person, places, and things because my heart beats that blood. Remember, we got iron in our body, and anytime there's any circumambulation taking place, let me call her. That's the brother right now. Let me call him real quick, family. Wow, that's dope. Hey, peace, my back. That's actually the brother, Nana Kwame Bediako, just hitting me up just now. Yeah, you already know. That's what's up. Yeah. And, you know, like I was saying, man, which I got to get off this phone real quick because it's an international line, so it's hard to stay on Facebook Live and also deal with those communications at the same time. But I love you guys, man. I'm about to connect and see what's going on for the evening. May have some power moves going on for tonight. But yeah, I'm just building with y'all. I'm glad I got my exercise in. Dang, I forgot. The bubbles ain't even bubbling right now. I'm over here building with y'all. Yeah, but y'all know what it is. I just want to bring something better. And I don't want to speak condescending. I want to just contribute to the community what I think is missing. So I could play my role, fulfill my part. That's it. I want to just offer you something that others may not have offered. That's it. You know, I don't want to talk bad about other people. I just want to say there's things that I feel are being overlooked, and rather than complain about them being overlooked in the community, I'll present them. Be it perspective, idea, ideas, or opportunity. But I thank y'all very much. I appreciate you. I love you. You are the best. Let's get it. Why the necessity for Calvin, Tarzan, Raphael to say I'm drinking strawberry soda? I may never know. And I hope I'm not plagued with this for the rest of the night. Some of y'all are tripping. But peace. Alright. And many blessings. I'm coming right now, baby. I was on live.
Uh-huh.
You was watching it?
Yep.
Yeah, the homie hit me up. He said he's been attempting to contact me this whole time. I've been live. But actually, I might have only missed him for like a couple minutes. So I'm about to touch base with him. I'm getting called probably. I don't know. I know. I always get told I sound like Jay-Z. I guess it's a Brooklyn thing more so. But he is like my favorite rapper anyway. Historically. Like, I'm like up there. So
what's
it about? I don't know. I'm about to find out.
Okay.
But hold up. I'm about to get off and follow you and we figure this out. Teach the language I invented. Okay, so what we're going to say is you learn Kuina Akuna, which means spiritual economics. We're talking about economic sovereignty. I'm probably going to change the title real quick, but let's also say this, Iluvu, which means perpetual success. When we see you, we say Tadu. Tadu means success and it means high, and Iluvu means goodbye, but it's synonymous with perpetual success. I realized that in cultures where people say peace be upon you, shalom, masalam, assalamu alaikum, I noticed that in those cultures, those people are succeeding more than the communities where people say what's cracking, what's popping. Good morning. Morning. There's nothing good about morning. It's a sad thing. Hello. Hell is low. We know what hell synonyms with an Obi and Omega, hell forever, you know, whatever. But when I hear the peace, I'm like, those communities seem to be striding just by the positive invocation that they emit in the form of their salutation. So I said, it suffice to say that we have to change the way we greet each other and leave each other. So I want to bring about success when I see you, because impressions are everything, right? So my first impression to you when I see you is success, and when I leave, I want to wish you perpetual success because we're lacking in it. So that's what I implore. I implore that you be successful. When I see you, I want to remind you of the success you are and what you're to be, and I also want to re-invite you to the idea or the notion when we're departing. So success to you. Perpetual success. Iluvu. Gave you some of the language. I answered a lot of questions tonight. Peace. I love you all.